Can I see your hand, please?
What is this?
This is a chemical burn. It'll hurt more than you've ever been burned, and you will have a scar.
What are you doing?
Guided meditation worked for cancer. It could work for this.
Stay with the pain. Don't shut this out.
No, no, no! God!
Look at your hand. The first soap was made from the ashes of heroes, like the first monkey shot into space. Without pain, without sacrifice, you would have nothing.
I tried not to think of the word serum or flesh.
Stop it!
This is your pain. This is your burning hand. It's right here.
I'm going to my cave. I'm going to my cave. I'm going to find my power animal.
No! Don't deal with it the way those dead people do. Come on!
I get the point, okay?
No,
please.
What you're feeling is premature enlightenment. This is the greatest moment of your life, man. And you're off somewhere miserable.
I am not.
Shut up. Our fathers were our models for God. If our fathers bailed, what does that tell you about God?
No, I don't.
Listen to me. You have to consider the possibility that God does not like you, never wanted you. In all probability, he hates you. Listen, you can run water over your hand to make it worse, or look at me, or you can use vinegar to neutralize the burn.
Please let me have it, please.
First, you have to give up. First, you have to know, not fear, know that someday you're gonna die.
You don't know how this feels.
It's only after we've lost everything that we're free to do anything.
Okay.
Congratulations. You're one step closer to hitting bottom.
What is the first rule of any game, Mr. Green?
The only way to get smarter is by playing a smarter opponent.
What's rule two of any game?
The more sophisticated the game, the more sophisticated the opponent.
Harmless the same, but where does it stop, Mr. Green? Where does this game stop?
It stops when you start to give me answers. Don't let them play head games with you, Jake.
Is it me that's playing head games with you, Mr. Green? You've heard that voice for so long, you believe it to be you. You believe it to be your best friend.
They should believe their opponent to be their best friend.
Where's the best place an opponent should hide?
The very last place you would ever look.
Do you know who Sam Gold is, Mr. Green? You should. Because he knows who you are.
The Gold. Sam Gold.
Mr. Clandestine. Mr. Ambiguous.
Mr. Mystery.
He's all up here. Pretending to be you.
No one sees gold. But gold sees everything.
You're in a game, Jake. You're in the game. Everyone's in his game. And nobody knows it. And all of this, this is his world. He owns it. He controls it.
I've had enough of this shit starting to do my head. Tell me I've had enough.
He tells you what to do.
Look, that's enough.
And when to do it.
Tell him.
I said that's enough, Avi!
Eventually, when the opponent is challenged or questioned, it means the victim's investment and thus his intelligence is questioned. No one can accept that. Not even to themselves.
He's behind all the pain there ever was. Behind every crime ever committed.
How can I be behind all the pain, all the crime, if I don't even exist?
And right now, he's telling you that he doesn't even exist.
No one lives. And displeases gold.
No one but your two friends.
We just put you to war with the only enemy that ever existed. And you. You think he's your best friend.
And they will protect their best friend. With everything they've got.
You're protecting him, Mr. Green. But with what? Where's the best place an opponent should hide? In the very last place you'd ever look. He's hiding behind your pain, Jake. You're protecting him with your pain. Embrace the pain, and you will win this game.
Digo is the worst confidence trickster we could ever figure, we could ever imagine, because you don't see it.
And the single biggest con is, I am you.
The problem is that the ego hides in the last place that you'd ever look, within itself.
It disguises its thoughts as your thoughts, its feelings as your feelings. You think it's you.
People's need to protect their own egos knows no bounds. They will lie, cheat, steal, kill, do whatever it takes to maintain what we call ego boundaries.
People have no clue that they're in prison. They don't know that there is an ego. They don't know the distinction.
At first, it's difficult for the mind to accept that there's something beyond itself, that there's something of greater value and greater capacity for discerning truth than itself.
In religion, the ego manifests as the devil. And of course, no one realizes how smart the ego is because it created the devil, so you could blame someone else.
In creating this imaginary external enemy, we usually made a real enemy for ourselves, and that becomes a real danger to the ego, but that's also the ego's creation.
There is no such thing as an external enemy, no matter what that voice in your head is telling you. All perception of an enemy is a projection of the ego as the enemy.
In that sense, you could say that 100% of our external enemies are of our own creation.
Your greatest enemy is your own inner perception, is your own ignorance, is your own ego.
As always, we have to remember who we are. We are spiritual beings, or also called souls. Now that's the best spiritual being I could do now. And as such, we have a very flexible ethereal body that can easily move in the spiritual and the semi-material and the material worlds. But in the material worlds, like here on Earth, it can only be an observer. It cannot really interact with the dense material environment. And if the soul wants to fully interact with the minerals, the plants, or the animal kingdoms, there we have a little piggy, or even with other human beings, the soul needs a body armor to survive in this dense vibration. Sort of, it's like, similar like these old diving suits they had, where you remember with this air hose to the boat for deep sea diving. It's a pressure suit. And this diving suit is our physical body. That's why we have incarnated into a body of bones and flesh. Our physical body is our vehicle to be able to move around here on Earth. Very much like we use a car to move around town. But it's very difficult for a soul to find itself in such a coarse and heavy and clumsy body armor. Of course, souls that have incarnated many times are used to this body, but there are lots of new souls as well who incarnate for the first time. And for them, it's very, very difficult to move around in this thing and to also take care of it. But here is where Mother Nature comes in with an ingenious feature and device. You remember all the electronics in your car that tell you when you are running low on gas or on brake fluid and all the other dangers, all these little lights that warn us? Well, our body armor has got the same kind of feature. It's the mind that tells our soul when to eat, it's a little apple here, or when to rest, or when there is danger, like falling off the cliff. It makes sure that the body will stay healthy and fit and serve us until we no longer need it and can return to the spiritual world. And this little mind that helps us to keep our body in shape is called the ego. Originally, the ego was only concerned with the well-being of the physical body. It's a great device if you come to think about it. But over hundreds of years and many, many incarnations, the souls forgot who they were and began to identify with their physical body. They thought they are their body. And the lure, the attraction of this physical body, are the five senses. These five senses were only meant to be a tool, but they became soon the focal point for many souls and the main reason to incarnate into this world. And the more the souls began to identify with their bodies, the more they began to crave for the fulfillment of certain pleasures, which they could do only via the five senses of the physical body. They fell deeply into sensuality. Wow. And of course, the most obvious one was the sense of touch, which is mostly enjoyed as sex. Originally, sex was designed for procreation and an expression of love for somebody we cared for. But now look what has happened. Our identification with our body and our addiction to sex has created this big sex industry. A brutal world with pornography, abuse, abductions of women and children, prostitution, organized crime. We are using other human beings only for the satisfaction of our sensuality. And another typical example is the sense of taste, originally meant to help us to differentiate between healthy and poisonous food. But now it became the main focus for many. We are continuously stuffing our face, whether we are in the streets, in the cinemas, or throughout the day. We do it all because our body runs us and not the other way around. And as a result, as a society, we have become obese. We want more and more. This little ego here has now become the big ego. And it wants more and more. And this ego, of course, has also made us greedy. Greed. The ego is making us greedy, and suddenly the idea of scarcity comes over us because we believe we are our body. But we remember Gandhi's famous word, there is enough on this earth for everybody's need, but not for everybody's greed. And now out of this comes fear and worry. Fear and worry. They come from the ego. Our higher self doesn't know fear and worries because it knows it's eternal and linked directly to God. But our body is afraid, and fear is of the earth, as Edgar Cayce reminds us, because the body knows it has a limited lifespan and it's very fragile. So it gives us fear and worry. And to get what it wants, we do not even hesitate killing other human beings. Booms. Just so that we can get their resources, like food, land, oil, and you name it. All for the survival and comfort of our body. That's right. Basically, all our wars are done for the survival and comfort of our physical bodies. Our big ego has now not only taken over our body, but also our psyche. It rules us. We have become a puppet of our ego. Remember what ego stands for? Edging God out? God, the source energy, has never forgotten us or given up on us. It has constantly given us guidance, inspiration, intuition via our soul, which some people call the sixth sense. But who is carefully listening to this guidance? Very few. Most of us have forgotten who we are in truth. We have given up listening to our inner voice that guides us. Instead, we are listening to our bloated ego, and subsequently, we are run by fear and worry. Nothing will change until we begin to remember who we are. That wonderful spiritual being that is imprisoned in this body that has run amok by our ego. And the more we know about the spiritual laws and use them, the sooner we can set this guy free, set our soul free.